Good afternoon, and welcome to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, psychologist, professor, author, blogger, podcaster, and your host. Today, our topic is dating in the coronavirus era. Maybe you've heard the dramatic and, dare I say, romantic case of the Brooklyn photographer who sent a drone to ask a woman out. Jeremy Cohen noticed the woman dancing on the roof of a building next to his own residence in Brooklyn. He was immediately struck by her enthusiasm and energy and found himself attracted to her. When she saw him, he waved, and so she waved back. And like so many attractions that begin across a crowded room, or in this case, across two sparsely populated rooftops, he knew he couldn't tell much about her from afar. So he wanted to get to know her better. There was only one problem. It was late March, and New York had been on lockdown for 2 weeks due to the coronavirus already. He couldn't walk next door to say hi. They couldn't meet for coffee. In fact, they couldn't meet in the traditional sense at all. So what could they do? Famously, Jeremy got creative. He remembered that he had a drone in his apartment. You know, one of those little foot-long, remote-controlled, four-propeller miniature helicopters. So he grabbed tape, pen, drone, and paper, jotted down his phone number along with the message, "Text me?" question mark, and piloted it across the gap between their buildings. When it landed next to his dancing neighbor, she was thoroughly entertained, and she decided to text him about an hour later. "Hi, it's the girl from the roof," her first message to him read. She told him her name was Tori, and they hit it off, at least as much as you can via text messaging. Given their positive experience, Jeremy decided to ask her out. "Want to get dinner with me?" he texted. "Yes," she responded, "but where and how? We're quarantined, LOL. Both Tori and Jeremy's roommates came to the rescue. 30 minutes before their scheduled date at 5 p.m., their roommates set up a table and chair on the edge of each of their respective roofs, complete with tablecloth, place setting, and even a glass of wine. At first, they shouted to one another across the rooftops, but it wasn't long until they both picked up their cell phones and got on FaceTime, where they could chat much more comfortably over video. The photos of them on their first quote-unquote date have since gone viral on the internet. I particularly found myself intrigued by one quote from Jeremy. In his words, quote, "The date was going so well, and depending on how long this quarantine lasts, I might be in a long-distance relationship with someone who lives across the street from me," unquote. Think about that for a moment. A long-distance relationship with someone who lives across the street. It's a statement that most likely no one ever uttered prior to just a few months ago. In fact, it wouldn't have even made sense if you'd heard it a year ago. But COVID-19 has changed a lot about our world, including how we date. So today on About Health, we'll talk about how the coronavirus has transformed dating. Are people still meeting in person? If so, what does a first date look like these days? And if they're not meeting in person, is it really possible for two people to get to know each other and kindle romance through a 7, 10, or even 14-inch screen? And will our time in quarantine change forever how people begin romantic relationships? Joining me by phone today is Dr. Loren Soeiro. Dr. Soeiro works as a psychologist in private practice in New York City. He is a fellow of the American Academy of Clinical Psychology and is board certified in clinical psychology by the American Board of Professional Psychologists. Before going into private practice, he worked in an outpatient HIV clinic at Montefiore Medical Center in the Bronx and was an assistant professor of clinical psychiatry at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. He writes about psychology and psychotherapy on psychcentral.com, goodtherapy.org, and for Psychology Today. His writings address, among a wide variety of topics, how online dating and dating apps are affecting how people connect with one another. One of his newest articles, titled "Single, Anxious, and Quarantined, Why Video Chat Dating Works Better Than You Think," will be the subject of much of today's interview. Dr. Loren Soeiro, welcome to About Health.
Hi, David. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's my pleasure. I'd like to start by just setting the context. You're a psychotherapist in private practice in New York City, the hardest hit city, I believe, with coronavirus in the U.S., and maybe one of the hardest hit in the world. Are you seeing clients right now, first of all? Obviously, a lot of what we're going to be talking about today will be based on your experience with the people you serve. So how have you been seeing clients these past few months of lockdown?
Right. Well, it's exclusively by video chat. There's a confidential video chat platform designed exclusively for telehealth called doxy.me, and I use that. I haven't seen a patient in person since mid-March.
You know, it really actually reminds me, it's sort of almost a harbinger of what we're going to talk about this hour, because much like dating, technology has kind of saved, in a sense, the way psychotherapy happens, but also has transformed the way therapists are connecting with clients over these platforms like Zoom and other, you know, confidential platforms. So let's get into that topic. As you've been meeting with your clients remotely, and particularly I'm interested in those who are single, are there common issues they're struggling with these days? I mean, we hear a lot about, like, loneliness, for instance. How have these months of lockdown affected the single people that you see?
Well, loneliness is very prominent. People are forced into isolation. Part of it has to do with, nowadays, it has to do with the lack of novelty of all the technological means of connection. I mean, in the first few weeks of quarantine, Zoom chats, Zoom family reunions, Zoom happy hours, they were everywhere all at once. Now, I think people are experiencing a little bit of video chat fatigue, and that causes people to hang back a little bit and avoid reaching out by technological means when they might have just a few weeks ago. So the longer this goes, I think the more people are feeling lonely and isolated.
Is the opposite also true, that, you know, sometimes somebody might be single, but they might be quarantining with their roommate and getting too much roommate time?
That happens too. I mean, you talked about single people, but I also see a lot of couples and members of relationships who are focusing on their relationship problems a little more than they might have been before. I think we read about a surge in divorces in China after the Wuhan lockdown was lifted. There are people here who are expecting the same thing. I spoke to a divorce attorney who was really looking for an uptick in business in the next few months.
And if people want to explore that topic more, towards the beginning of the lockdown, I believe it was in late March or early April, I did an interview with Dr. Adam Dorsey, actually, on how to cope with coronavirus anxiety. But we got a lot into relationship issues and how to navigate relationships in the midst of that. But focusing in on single people, what about their love life? I mean, at the beginning of the pandemic, I can imagine there was all of this anxiety about coronavirus itself and this novelty with Zoom and all of that. But even if they're with their roommate, I imagine over time, a different kind of loneliness sets in because people aren't able to connect romantically as easily. So how is this affecting, like, the love life of the clients that you see who are single?
Well, I do feel like anxiety is what some people see as the only alternative to loneliness. Reaching out to people over video chat or even just online dating, which is prominent anyway, causes a lot of anxiety in some people. And so for some, it seems like an awful choice, either be lonely or go through this difficult experience. And somebody told me that she would rather jump out of the window next to her, behind her in the video chat screen, than try video chat dating.
Oh, I hope she doesn't, that's for sure. But, you know, point well taken that this is a new world and it causes unique anxieties. And we're going to be talking a lot about how online dating, video chat dating is changing things, but also how it's challenging us emotionally But actually, before I get into that, I wanted to start by just asking about in-person dates. Are people, in your experience, still meeting for in-person dates, even though, of course, we've been quarantined?
Well, since the start of the quarantine, that has happened. I did talk to several people who were pretty determined to go on meeting and dating in person. In one case, it seemed to be a situation where somebody was not really attending to how the other party might feel about this. You know, somebody who was a little more willing to reach out and meet in person and share space and maybe even have physical intimacy, and probably not thinking enough about how nowadays it's important to match your own desire for safety, your own level of concern about the coronavirus for that of your would-be partner. In other cases, I've heard it go wrong in other ways, where people are on a date, meeting for the first time, you know, spend a lot of time checking it out with each other and making sure that each of them had quarantined appropriately and was not presenting a risk to each other. And then on their first evening together, one of them presumed that the other was kind of practically starting a relationship, practically ready to start a relationship, just taking the step of reaching across the gap to get together represented a really, really big, even gesture at commitment to one party, but not to the other.
Have you seen a shift in people's willingness to have in-person dates since the early days of quarantine? In the San Francisco Bay Area, for instance, we've been in some version of shelter in place since mid-March. And I think that's pretty much the same for New York. But being in lockdown for months can be really fatiguing. Have you found that in the people that you serve, the people that you know, that people are growing more lax about in-person dates, or is it pretty much the same as always?
I do keep hearing from people things like, I'm over the coronavirus, what has really changed? Where are we? What's different now? So I expect that the way that it was front of mind for so long is starting to recede.
Yeah, I think about the same thing. Because for me, when I look at the statistics, it seems to me that there's still quite a bit of risk out there. And I think my latest view of the Bay Area statistics, at least, show that we're up in terms of daily cases as people start to relax. And so that concerns me a little bit. Like anything else in life, we kind of get used to it. It starts to seem less important. And then I'm worried that people will venture out more and have these dates and take risks that are maybe unnecessary. I'm wondering has New York made any specific statements about if in-person dating is allowed or advisable at this point? My understanding is they made some kind of controversial statements at the beginning of the lockdown, right?
That's right. I think there was a message from the New York Department of Health, which advised and encouraged people not to do any in-person dating. It even went so far as to suggest that the safest sex you could have would be solitary sex, I think that was their phrase, or having sex with the people that you already live with. People sent this back and forth on Twitter an awful lot. And
saying they're telling us to have sex with our roommates or something
exactly,
like that.
Exactly, exactly. Complicating those relationships.
Well, these sorts of announcements do highlight how complicated it is these days to think through how to ask a person out on a date, where to go, whether to go, whether to ask them out at all. And we're going to get into a lot of that. But before we do that, let me just ask you, do you have any thoughts for what distinguishes people who decide to have an in-person date versus those who don't? And I imagine it's a big, it depends, and there are a lot of factors, but I'm thinking there might be things like personality, proneness to anxiety. On the other hand, it might be something about stage of relationship. Like, for instance, people who are already dating before the pandemic might, even if they're not deep into a relationship, right, might be more willing to continue in-person dating than someone who just met during the pandemic. Do you have any reflections on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, a few things. In one case, you know, I think anxiety level is a big component of it. Anxiety is not just a disorder; it's sort of a part of everybody's experience in the world one way or another. And some people organize their personalities around it more than others. And so I think that people who find or discover that their would-be partner has about the same level of anxiety or focuses their anxiety in the same things as they do may be maybe even paradoxically more comfortable in meeting that type of person. I also, I mean, when it comes to anxiety, what a lot of people do to not feel it or to feel relief from it is to defend against it using psychological defense mechanisms like denial or avoidance. And that may encourage people to charge out there and worry less about something that actually is a threat. And by ignoring it, they gain some sense of mastery over that emotion, just putting aside those facts for the moment. It gives them a little relief. But as for the last part of your question about stage of relationship, that's also been having an effect. There are people who were together, were kind of evaluating each other, or just had started dating in the first few weeks of this pandemic, who then made the decision to quarantine together or to bubble up, as some people say, and that can kind of artificially accelerate the intimacy, like I suggested earlier. When you depend on somebody and you have to trust them to that degree, it really puts a certain pressure on your relationship that that you have to be worthy of.
That's a really interesting thought, that to a certain degree, this pandemic is pushing people to be intimate, at least emotionally intimate, quicker. Is that what you're saying? Expand on that a little bit.
It can. I mean, I often think about trust as a kind of an indicator of intimacy or a method of achieving or deepening intimacy. And in a situation like this, where trusting that somebody else is taking care of their own hygiene and their own social distancing measures, mask wearing, hand washing, what have you, you also know that that person is taking care of you. So it's it accelerates the idea that you're putting your emotions into that other person's hands. You're also putting your health into that other person's hands.
Yeah. Well, you're listening to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest is psychologist Dr. Loren Soeiro. And we're talking about the challenges of dating in the midst of coronavirus. In particular, we're addressing how COVID-19 is impacting in-person dating. Later in the show, we'll also talk about how it's transforming online dating. Because this is a pre-recorded show, unfortunately, we can't take calls today, which is too bad, because I bet we'd have a lot of them. So, Dr. Soeiro, getting back to this issue of how coronavirus is changing the nature of in-person dates, over the last month or so, we've seen states and localities start to reopen, which has made in-person dates more possible, or at least more legally allowed. But as areas have reopened, we've also seen rises in COVID-19 cases in a lot of places. And as of the first airing of this show in early July, this has caused some states and local governments to either pause their reopening plans or roll them back a bit. So as of this moment, in-person dates are more possible in some areas than others. I have to say, I'm not sure whether in-person dates are advisable anywhere. I think personally, in my opinion, I would advise against them because they seem pretty risky to me. And we also need to keep in mind that, you know, depending on how careful we've been about our quarantine, we're also potentially, you know, putting the other person at risk too. But if people do meet in person, how does the fact that it's happening in the midst of this pandemic and the risk of getting the virus, how do you think it's going to affect the character of the date? And I'm asking really about both sides of things. We're already talking a little about the emotional side of things and how it kind of dials up the intimacy. But I'm also wondering about the logistics. Things like, do people social distance? Do they meet outside or inside? what's it going to be like to be on a date with someone where you can't get closer than 6 or 7 feet? Will it make it more intense, less intense? What do you think these dates are going to look like?
Well, that's going to vary as well. I mean, there are people who have been chatting over video chat for several weeks now, maybe even talking every night, and are now just getting set to meet for the first time. I mean, in one case, I'm aware of somebody who is flying across the country to meet in person with somebody that they have only chatted with over Zoom. I mean, that kind of recalls the early days of the internet when people would throw over their marriages for someone that they had met in a chat room.
Intense.
But the other possibility happens too, where there are people who first meet in video chat and are desperately hoping that the people they meet are going to be worth meeting in person. You know, worth getting the coronavirus for. You know, otherwise this idea of having an in-person date, you know, strolling down the street 6 feet apart, maybe sitting apart and sipping from two separate bottles of wine might seem like too much of a rigmarole.
We were talking before the show a little bit, you and I, and you said that you actually had a client who said, I want to meet somebody, and if I'm going to meet somebody, they better be worth getting the coronavirus for. And I think that's kind of a million-dollar quote and really makes you think about how dating has taken on a new intensity and depth that maybe we haven't seen for a while or maybe ever in history.
Yeah. Yeah, that's possible. I mean, like I said earlier, I mean, you're kind of throwing yourself into the unknown and you're hoping that this other person is going to be worth doing that for in every way, being just as trustworthy as you would have wanted before, just as interested in a long-term relationship, if that's what you're interested in, and then also able to protect your health by matching your own level of concern.
How do people negotiate that? Obviously, people are going to have different tolerances for where they're willing to meet, how much social distance they need, whether or not they insist on wearing masks, and lots of other things. And it just seems like this adds so much complexity to asking someone out or agreeing to a date. As you've talked to people in your psychotherapy practice, how do you hear from them that they're going about negotiating these issues with potential dates? And do you have any tips if someone's listening out there and thinking, well, you know, maybe not right this second, but eventually I might want to go out on an in-person date with someone? How would you suggest they go about starting that conversation?
Well, I always recommend communicating openly about important things like your concern. I mean, and previously this was always about stuff like safe sex, but at the moment it's about safe physical contact or safe sharing the same room, the same physical space. Mm-hmm. If you're anxious about having that conversation, I actually recommend disclosing that anxiety, maybe even just saying, you know, I'm not sure how to talk about this. It seems weird. It makes me feel a little uncomfortable, but I it's really important to me to kind of make sure that I don't get sick, and I wanted to know whether you also have been careful about your quarantine or how often you wash your hands, how often you wear a mask. I mean, because you really will need to find someone whose level of concern matches yours and who's going to take your concerns into account.
I know I've talked to friends and even colleagues who are single and who have been hesitant to have that conversation because they think, oh, will I sound crazy? Does this make me sound too picky? And my response to them has been, look, if you really think it's worth meeting with this person, because in the cases of the people I was talking to, you think this might be somebody that you want to get to know and maybe explore the possibility of a long-term relationship with, doesn't that start with trust? And if merely bringing that up is enough to cause them to ghost you or drive them away, maybe they weren't the right person in the first place. Does that kind of accord with your advice?
It does. I mean, I think that reaching out to a new person and trying to forge a new relationship is taking a risk. You're taking a risk of rejection. And in response, that other person, if they're worthwhile, will give you a soft landing. They'll make it okay that you took that risk and maybe reach out by taking a risk of his or her or their own. Intimacy can only be achieved by taking these personal risks.
Yeah, I mean, that's the definition of intimacy, right? Is making yourself vulnerable to the other person, which of course is scary, at least at the beginning. So we've talked a lot about in-person, and present in the background of this conversation the whole time has been dating apps, because a lot of these conversations that we're talking about preparing for an in-person date, if people are willing to take that risk, and as I said, I wouldn't recommend it at this point, all that happens via the internet or phone or some kind of electronic medium these days. So let's transition a little bit to talking about online dating in the era of coronavirus. I personally was shocked to read that apps like Tinder and Grindr are reporting an increase in usage. And I know you know the statistics because you wrote about them in your Psych Today article. So how much are usage of these apps on the rise these days?
Well, as of a few weeks ago, in places like New York and San Francisco, messages going back and forth on apps like Bumble increased by almost 25%. I think it was 23% in New York and 26% in San Francisco.
That's huge. And I have to admit, it still surprises me when I hear that, because I think of these dating apps like Bumble, like Tinder, like Grindr, and there's so many others, I think of them as hookup apps, apps that people use to quickly meet somebody to then go out and meet in person or maybe even have a one-night stand. I should add that caveat that I've been in a monogamous relationship with my partner for 13 years. So I'm kind of out of the dating scene and certainly out of the online dating scene. And it's very possible I'm wrong about this. So let me put that to you. How were apps like Tinder and Bumble and OkCupid and Grindr, how were they being used before the pandemic? Were they just hookup apps, or am I wrong?
Well, I have to say it was a little more complicated than that. This is a question that's been studied or and is being studied by a scientist known as Elizabeth Timmermans, who works at Erasmus University in the Netherlands. According to what she called the Big Tinder Project, casual sex was only the 11th most popular reason that people use Tinder, just above to forget their ex. Yeah, the first most common use was just to pass the time, just like people playing video games while waiting for the subway, just to make the time go by. After that, I think people were just getting onto Tinder because they're curious who else is on it, what might happen if they get on, to see who's on there, what those people look like. Some people just like to socialize in friendly, non-romantic ways, and that, I think, was the third most popular reason. Just behind that was a serious effort to find love. And the fifth most popular reason was just looking for an ego boost, putting your photo out there and hoping that someone will give it a thumbs up.
Wow. So this leads me, as you're talking about all these different reasons to use these apps, I'm wondering how successful people are with these dating apps. As you've mentioned, people use these apps for all kinds of goals, and they go on dates for all kinds of reasons as well. And I'll admit, in preparation for the show, I was kind of thinking back in my own life, and many years ago, before I met my partner, and we're talking about 15 years ago, I'll admit that my goal wasn't always to find somebody to love in the medium or long term. I went on dates to have fun, and I was always honest and always straightforward about that.
Right.
But I'm assuming that for many people, the goal is still to eventually find that special person. So how well do these dating apps work? And I've read that, like, before the coronavirus, not so well.
Right. From what I've read, it's something like 10% or fewer of the matches of online matches actually result in even a real world meetup. But You know, I spoke to a salesman once who told me that the more no's you get, the more yeses you get. So you have to increase that that number of yeses somehow just by keeping on swiping.
I think that's an interesting insight. And I remember thinking that when I was on the dating market. I can be kind of shy, despite the fact that here I am on the radio a couple times a month. I can still be kind of shy and a little low self-esteem at times. And one of the best pieces of advice that someone once gave me, and it was actually a statistician who gave it to me, was to say, you know, it's a numbers game. Mm-hmm. And you're putting yourself out there. You have a profile. Try not to worry how people judge those 10 sentences and one or two photos that you put up. That's not you. You just got to try. And the more you try, the more you're likely to get that one person that maybe is worth meeting or worth dating or worth getting to know more. So I think that's really strong advice.
Right.
I do wonder, though, is the use of these dating apps or the successful use, if you want to call it that, the degree to which they yield relationships, do you think that's changing in the coronavirus era? Are people using these apps differently now that we're in quarantine?
Well, I'm not sure that we can say yet, but this has been something that's been changing over the years pretty profoundly. I mean, in 2013, I think that a study indicated that more than a third of American marriages were beginning online. And by 2017, there was a shift in all of relationships. 39% of heterosexual relationships and 65% of same-sex relationships were that begin online. I can imagine that trend is continuing. And the focus on video chat these days is probably going to accelerate it.
Yeah, so let's get into that video chat question. So people are meeting on, you know, Tinder or Grindr or Bumble or one of these. And most of these, I think, if I'm not mistaken, don't have video chat or audio chat built in. And so then they're transitioning then to video dates. Am I right to say that?
Right. Right. This is, it might at one time have been seen as a kind of a half measure. You know, why not just go from a text to a meet up in person? But at the moment, it's the best that most people can imagine feeling comfortable with. And so it's working in a big way for a lot of people. It also offers some people a way to quickly check whether they have a basic connection with the other person, whether their conversations pause and start in a natural way, and whether they have something in common to chat about. So it may become a part of the process, that like, should we meet in person step that hasn't been there to date.
Well, I'm David B. Feldman, and today on About Health, I'm having a conversation with psychologist Dr. Loren Soeiro about dating in the coronavirus era. How has COVID-19 and the need to quarantine ourselves changed the face of dating? And how is it likely to affect dating in the future? As a reminder, this is a pre-recorded interview, so unfortunately we're not able to take your calls today. And Dr. Soeiro, I'm fascinated by what you just said, that this may be one way that the coronavirus pandemic and the lockdowns that we've been a part of will change dating forever. People used to, you know, meet online, perhaps, or maybe they would meet at a bar or at a party, but then they would transition relatively quickly to a coffee date or something like that. And what you're saying is maybe permanently with us will be this idea that no, we're going to meet for a video kind of date, a screening first. What do these video dates look like? I know it's pretty nascent. We're still relatively new to this idea of video chat dating, but you know, we know what an in-person date looks like. Maybe you meet for coffee or dinner. It lasts an hour or two. And even if you end up not really connecting with the person, there's still that social pressure to see the date through to the end. But what do online video dates look like?
Well, people have gotten creative. I mean, I think what most people want out of these dates is just someone to have a person who is important to you that you look forward to talking to every day and that you you feel good when you share about yourself with. You know, people seem to want and need that these days, especially when they're more isolated than usual.
Sure.
People have gotten creative with video chat dates with a lot of co-watching apps websites where you can watch the same movie at the same time as somebody who isn't in your house. I've also talked to several people who are doing puzzles. Apparently puzzles have been big sellers on a lot of the online retailers over the last couple of months. And in at least one case, two people that I work with were doing a puzzle separately in their separate homes and then just kind of showing it to each other using their phones as they talked every night. I mean, there hasn't been much going on in their lives in terms of what their work has been. Both are confined to their homes, but so they don't have much to talk about otherwise, but they do at least have this thing that they're doing together in common.
It seems like you're kind of getting at the idea that there are a lot of advantages to video dates, and I want to talk about the disadvantages and the challenges too, but let's start with the advantages. I wonder if you could just go through some of these for a minute. What are the good things about video dates versus in-person ones?
Well, I mentioned anxiety before. I mean, meeting people for the first date, being evaluated, taking risks has always been something that provokes anxiety. But at the moment, meeting someone for the first time, you don't have to leave the safety of your home. You know, you can dress yourself and arrange your background to be whatever you'd like. You don't have to travel. You won't have to spend money. You won't have to order from a menu that you're not comfortable with or say yes to something that your date wants to order that you don't actually want to eat or drink. By the end, I mean, if a date is not going well, you can pretty quickly and easily disengage. Just shut your laptop. Even if it does go well, people like the idea of having a couple of hours of conversation and then turning off their computer and rolling over into bed, and that's the evening. I've heard people feeling pretty good about the lack of commuting time attached to their dating.
I'm also wondering about personal safety, like physical safety, and I'm not just thinking about the risk of catching the coronavirus. That's important, of course. I'm also thinking about, you know, there's always risk involved in meeting a stranger. Sexual assault is a real problem, including on dates. And then, of course, there's often pressure, or there can be pressure, from one person to another to engage in a level of sexual activity that maybe the other person isn't comfortable with. So are you hearing any sense of relief from some of your clients or some of the people you know about the fact that, you know, you can have a video date instead of shouldering some of those risks?
Yeah. I mean, I mentioned earlier some of the people who were willing to ignore the risks in hopes of achieving physical intimacy, but the opposite has been true as well. There are people who are really glad that online dating is slow these days. It has slowed down an awful lot. I mean, on the one hand, it gives people a chance to sort of weed out the phonies before you even spend any time with them, or to weed out people that might give you the creeps all of a sudden. That's something that you wouldn't notice through a text chain. People are also being forced to wait a little longer and get to know each other better before they decide whether they should even go so far as to meet each other in person. And some of these people once were very comfortable having sex early in a relationship. So in general, dating and the pace of intimacy has slowed down a lot.
Yeah, it's weird to think that in the 21st century, with all of our technology and now combined with this pandemic, that in a way, in a kind of odd way, we're returning to the stereotype of what I think of as old-fashioned dating, right? Slowly getting to know each other before engaging physically with each other. And while there are disadvantages of that, I mean, there's something wonderful about being sexually freer and our ability to be sexually freer in the late 20th century, early 21st century than, say, people were 100 years before. But it also seems like there are some really nice things about being able to slow it down and not having that pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering, are there people for whom online dating is working better or worse? You mentioned shy people and people with social anxiety or people who worry a lot about the way they look, which is a lot of people. On the one hand, I can imagine online dating being easier as for the reasons you've mentioned. They're in the comfort of their own home. They may feel less emotionally vulnerable. But on the other hand, I can also imagine online dating, in particular video dating, being really hard. Because I'll just speak for me, having a camera pointed at me can make me feel really exposed. So what are your thoughts about this dichotomy? Are there people for whom, categories of people for whom video dating is better or worse?
Well, you mentioned having that camera pointed at you. And yeah, people talk about that all the time, having a little window off to the top right of your screen where you can see how you look. It can really throw you off your game, as it were, in a video date. I often recommend that people shut off that window so that they don't have to see themselves. They might be able to lose themselves a little better in their conversations. But even without that, there's a loss of eye contact that that really can throw off some developing intimacy. Depending on how far you are from your computer screen, you're staring at a spot on the screen that's 3, 4, 5 inches lower than this camera, which is looking at your eyes. And so the person who you see on the screen, or the way the other person sees you, is not a direct eye contact. It's almost like they see you looking at their chin. Nobody stares directly into the camera, although that would be the only way for one person to simulate eye contact.
Because you mentioned it in your Psych Today article, I know you had a client recently who said something like, I just can't feel anything over a webcam.
Right.
And I think we're really wired as a species to make connections in person. So first of all, am I right to say that? And why is that? And second, I wonder if you could just take a minute or two to talk about how you think that this could impact video dates and our ability to establish intimacy. And if you have any advice for how to make video dates work better.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, some people do have difficulty making connections over the webcam. I always recommend that they keep trying, though, because, I mean, personally, I've done an awful lot of video psychotherapy over the past few months. And while at first it felt very unnatural for a lot of the people I work with, that lack of naturalness has really fallen away. And in some cases, I even think that the connections have been better. Maybe it's because of that sense of safety where you're no longer meeting in person and you have your own environment around you. Maybe it's what people used to feel when they were just two high school students talking on the phone for hours and hours at night, just reaching out to each other and not worrying about all those other factors. In terms of what makes video chat dating better, I mean, there are recommendations out there on the web already about how to dress, how to position the angle of your webcam, and how to arrange the background behind you. I think it's more about taking risks again, and trying to reach out to people this way, trying your best to offer a genuine side of yourself, and not being as afraid of being judged as you might be worried about.
It almost seems like direct communication, verbal communication, takes on more of an importance when you're talking on a 7-inch screen. Because when you're meeting in person, there's so much nonverbal communication. Like you said, there's this eye contact. There's the way that you sigh or the way that you sit or the way that you smile. And some of that comes across on mm-hmm. video chat, but so much of that information is lost. And so I wonder what your thoughts are about it. Does that make verbal communication and being a little more direct than we might normally be more important in video dating than in-person dating?
It might. I mean, the only way to advance the intimacy between two people now is to talk about yourself in a more open and honest way. I mean, assuming you're not going to meet in person. The shortcut of physical intimacy is generally not there at the moment. So the best way to make those connections and to find a real maybe even find a real relationship is to be as real as you possibly can yourself.
Well, and speaking about being real, how common is it to lie in online dating? So I've read something like, and this is before the pandemic, but something like 80% of people lie in their dating profiles, in what they write about themselves online, at least about something like their height or their weight or their age. So does the fact that more dating is happening online mean it's easier to be dishonest, or are people trying to be more honest, or do you have concerns about that?
Well, I think that something about that dishonesty does wash away when you see somebody in person. You know, you're not even just looking at a potentially doctored photo of them taken at the best day of their lives. You're actually seeing how they look right now and how they look when they're talking to you. But yeah, it's always going to be possible to conceal parts of yourself if you're determined to. As I've been saying, it's not a very reliable way to develop, to forge a new connection.
Yeah, there's so many concerns. I mean, not the advantages notwithstanding, and there are huge advantages. Let me ask about another thing that sort of goes down this alley of the challenges or the problems of online dating, and that is inequities in access to online dating. And I don't expect that you have a magic answer to this, because it's a huge problem. But it's definitely something I want to bring up. And I'm really thinking about two broad groups of people here. First, I'm thinking about older people. Maybe they're single, divorced, widowed. They might be in their 60s, 70s, or 80s. I know my parents, for instance, who are both in their 70s. They're still together, so they're not doing online dating. But if they did try to use apps like Tinder, they would have a hard time. They have a hard time using Zoom. Certainly not everybody who's older has trouble with technology, but some do. And so the second group of people that I'm thinking about may even be more important, which is those people not able to afford a computer or a cell phone, or a computer or a cell phone that's fast enough or new enough to do video chat. And in many ways, this second group of people are also those people who are most affected health-wise, right, by the coronavirus pandemic itself. As I said, I don't think you have a solution here. It's a little like we're trying to build the plane while we're flying it. But any thoughts about these kinds of inequities?
It does seem like something that could really profoundly affect what we understand about video chat dating or online dating, when you consider that the people who are answering all these studies or doing most of the online dating are by and large the same types of people who are in the same socioeconomic group, who have enough money and enough access to technology, and maybe live in the places where these apps are popular to participate.
Yeah, and I wonder, and I think about how this is going to affect things moving forward. If we're moving more as a society to video dating, I mean, it used to be, you mentioned before that you said something like, you know, video dating doesn't cost money, and it's true. It doesn't cost money. You don't have to go out in one sense and buy dinner or pay an admission to a movie or something like that. But in another sense, it does cost money, because you have to be able to afford the good computer. And, you know, sometimes some fancy dating services have subscription fees, and you have to have the relatively fancy phone, and you have to be able to afford your internet connection and one that's fast enough to do good video chat. I mean, in a way, in-person dating before was kind of free. You could always have a date in a park or walk around or something like that. But now you need all of this relatively expensive equipment. And so I wonder if this moving forward is going to create a kind of two-tiered system. People who can have these good dates over the internet, and then the people who can't afford to. And again, I don't think you've got any solution to that, but I just wanted to highlight it for people listening.
Yeah, and it occurs to me that many people these days are affected by the need for childcare or the lack of definition of their work hours. So it may be harder for them to even find the time that they would need to put into the search or their video chat dates.
Yeah, really, really important point. I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest on About Health today is psychologist Dr. Loren Soeiro. And as you can hear, we're talking about how the coronavirus is transforming the way people date. Because this is a pre-recorded show, we can't take calls today. So Dr. Soeiro, we're coming up on the last maybe 5 or 6 minutes, and I want to get really practical. So if someone's listening right now and they're thinking, okay, I'm ready to start trying online dating. You know, maybe they've stopped dating during the pandemic. Can you offer some really practical tips for how to make online dating work? And I'm thinking about all stages, right? From having a good profile to setting your expectations properly and making the first contact, all the way through to that video date.
Right. I mean, you'll find if you look on the internet several stories of computer experts who are able to hack the online dating experience. There's a woman who gave a TED talk about this and a man who told the story on The Moth. And in both cases, it worked like gangbusters. But if you're not a hacker, then I mean, there are some very basic things to do. I mean, you mentioned setting your expectations properly. Earlier, I said that you know something like only 10% of online connections result in a real-world meetup. And I think it's important to realize that even if you get 9 rejections in a row or 9 losses of interest in a row, that doesn't constitute a trend. That's not a way to judge yourself. I also think that when you start with your profile from the beginning, you'll want to include more photos. That's the first thing to do. Just having one photo, even if it's a good one, can cut down your rate of response by a third or something. When you add a couple more photos, increasing from 1 to 3, for women you'll show a 37% increase in matches, and for men it's something like 5 times the number of matches if you just add 2 more photos. In these photos, you should probably look straight at the camera. So, I mean, there's actual studies about whether people look are more attractive to others when they have a direct gaze as opposed to an averted gaze. This will also seem a bit obvious, but it is important to smile. Even attractive faces have been studied and shown to be more attractive to others when they smile.
And I've heard this advice many times, and every time I hear it, I think, oh my gosh, how superficial. But really, if you stop and think about it, it's consistent with what we know from research about how people form attachments, right? We're wired to need that facial feedback. I wonder if you could fill that in just a little bit for us. This isn't really a superficial thing. It's just how we connect, right?
That's right. Some schools of thought about the way emotions are communicated to each other through expressions on your face. And I think that this can happen over the video chat screen just as well as it does in person. You can really read someone's response to what you're saying. But this all starts from that initial photo where it's important to show somebody else what it looks like when you feel happy.
And what about when you do make that contact and you maybe are chatting via text or chatting via video? Any advice in the last 1 or 2 minutes to leave people on about it? Just how to start that conversation?
Well, I always encourage people to be themselves as much as they can be, to think of themselves as evaluating the other person, not simply being evaluated themselves. But at the same time, you do need to risk rejection by taking interpersonal risks and telling stories about yourself, being genuine. Even if your favorite ice cream flavor happens to be vanilla and you're worried that that's going to be boring, I recommend saying it anyway. And if you have to, like throw in a little self-deprecating joke about it, showing that you know that about yourself. But you can't find intimacy if you aren't willing to risk rejection for those reasons.
And I think what you said right before that is also super valuable, that keep in mind, as you're thinking a lot about how to present yourself to this other person and how to look good on the camera and what to say to this other person so they'll evaluate you positively, that really you're evaluating them too, and that you owe it to yourself to select carefully. And so don't forget that this is as much about you and you're getting a read on them as it is them getting a read on you. I think that's so important for people to keep in mind. Well, Dr. Loren Soeiro, thank you so much for spending time with us today on About Health. It's been a really interesting conversation and I think an important one. If people want to learn more about you, how could they go about doing that?
Well, they can find me on the internet. My website is my name. It's lorensoeiro.net, and because it's a complicated name, I'll spell it. My first name is Loren, L-O-R-E-N, and my last name is Soeiro, S-O-E-I-R-O.
lorensoeiro.net. And I also might recommend to people to read Dr. Soeiro's Psychology Today blog, which is how I found him, which I believe is titled I Hear You. And you
That's
can
right.
access that by searching on psychologytoday.com. So thank you again, Dr. Soeiro, for joining us on About Health.
Well, I'm delighted. Thank you.
And my thanks to all of you, our listeners. You're the reason we do this. And I sincerely hope that this hour has been helpful to you. I'm David B. Feldman. If you'd like to find out more about me, you can visit my website, davidfeldmanphd.com, all one word. If you'd like to hear this episode again or listen to any of our past episodes, you can find them on kpfa.org. Just select About Health under the Programs page. And of course, I hope you'll continue to join us here each week as we explore important issues impacting your health. From all of us here at About Health, may you be healthy, happy, and wise. Thanks for listening.
Hi, this is David Talbot, author of Season of the Witch and the Devil's Chessboard. In these days when news and culture are so formatted and corporatized, I rely on KPFA more and more. Shows like Flashpoints, Project Censor, Democracy Now!, and for fun, Dirk Richardson's Here and Now. They keep me going, and I know they keep you going too. So please join me in supporting KPFA. It's an essential community resource. Thank you.
Hi, this is Nomi Prince. As everyone knows, we live in a world in which it gets harder and harder each day to wade through the seemingly endless stream of lies. That's why now, more than ever, it's crucial for brave and objective media like KPFA to thrive. Public radio serves the public, period. So please consider donating whatever you can today to help KPFA remain a beacon of truth.
Donate today at kpfa.org.
William Shakespeare wrote this poem. It's a 116th sonnet that starts, "Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediment." So this is my Black English translation. Don't let me mess up partner happiness because the troubles start and I ain't got the heart to deal. That wouldn't be real about love if I push come to shove, just punk. Now, hardly, hey, love do not cooperate with cop-out provocations, no. Storm come, storm go away, but love stay steady if you ready or you not. Love True love stays steady. True love stay high.
June Jordan, a voice synonymous with passion, integrity, and vision. No other station has been bringing you voices like these except KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.